and welcome to Media MD, your fortnightly Doof Network dose of media that you have somehow missed. I'm Ruben Morehouse.
And I'm Elliot Diebold.
And we are back to talk about The Boys.
The Boys.
So, yeah, pretty messed up, right?
yeah, but in all the good ways.
Well, some of the good ones. Some of the good ones. do you want to give us that plot summary that we also crave? Yes.
So, okay. The Boys... It kind of has two threads ongoing, although they're obviously quite intertwined. So I'd say the main character is this guy called Huey.
Mm-hmm.
And he's kind of this, you know, nice guy who's not really going anywhere in life and is dating this girl who's sort of way too good for him and basically just exists to set him on a revenge path because she gets quite brutally killed
in the opening episode. Yes, it's pretty brutal, isn't it?
It's, I was laughing my head off for that scene.
It sets like the tone, doesn't it? It really, like, right off the bat, you're like, oh, this is what this is going to be.
Yeah, it's so overly, ridiculously gratuitous. Like, my reaction just went fully back around to sort of laughing at it. Like, the way he's left standing there with her, hand, like, her forearms in his hand still is just horrifying.
Yeah.
Anyway, so Huey, as he's sort of recovering from this, is approached by
Carl Urban.
I was just gonna say Carl Urban.
that's fine. You can just call him Carl. I think his name is T Boy.
Oh, Billy. It's Billy Butcher.
Oh yeah, Billy Boy.
Yes, and of course, so Carl Urban is playing Billy Butcher, who is a Cockney British / Australian / New Zealand character, apparently. Carl Urban seemingly couldn't make up his mind there.
That's very Carl Urban, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of liked it. It was funny how I mean, obviously, right from the get-go, you don't really trust that Billy Butcher is, like, a good person.
Yeah.
But I couldn't help but think that part of my distrust for him was that he had an Australian accent for a lot of the first episode, and Lord of the Rings has trained me not to trust my own accent in film.
Yeah, it's interesting, because he is, like... very much, like, you kind of expect him to end up being worse than he is, I felt.
Yeah, I did, actually. And that actually applies to most of the seven as well. I think something this show does quite well is at the start, I was very much thinking, okay, well, apart from Starlight and Huey, there are no heroes in this. It's all villains. Yeah. And then towards the end, I was sort of like, no, it's a bit more grey than that. It's just a bunch of flawed people, really.
Yeah. Yeah. I really liked how nuanced... basically, all the characters ended up being. Like, I can't think of a single character that didn't feel like they had some nice depth to them.
No, I agree. Absolutely. Anyway, so Carl Urban recruits Huey to help him out, trying to get revenge on the superheroes who are sort of killing people and not being held to account for it.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a very noble cause that Billy handles very unnobly.
Yes.
Bunch of shenanigans ensue. They drag some more people into their cause, and things sort of go really wrong, and they end up sort of fighting directly against the superheroes, but luckily they end up with one superhero on their side, and it's this new superhero girl called Starlight.
And that's the other plot of the show, Starlight's entry into the Seven, which is the Justice League, basically.
The Seven are the premier superhero group in the world, and they're basically the Justice League. I mean, there's like a one-to-one mapping of everyone but Starlight to a main Justice League person.
Yeah.
It's not... I don't think they're even subtle about it.
It's pretty blatant. Translucent isn't really... like, there's no Justice League member that's super known for just kind of turning invisible.
Martian Manhunter does that, doesn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah, but that's not his thing, no, right?
Yeah, to be fair, I haven't seen many Justice League things, but for the most part, like, Queen Maeve's blatantly Wonder Woman. Yes. Homelander's blatantly Superman. Yep. The Deep is blatantly Aquaman. Yep. Lamplighter, I'd even say, is pretty blatantly Green Lantern, even though we don't see him. And I think that's even a meta joke in and of itself.
Yeah. And then there's the one who's the Batman-esque character, whose name I can't remember.
He almost struck me as more of a Deathstroke. Black Noir.
Black Noir, that's right. And then obviously there's the Flash, who is A-Train.
I kept expecting Black Noir to go somewhere this season, but he didn't. I'm assuming next season.
I hope he never goes anywhere. the best thing about Black Noir is that he's just, like, so removed from the story.
So basically Starlight gets accepted into the Seven, which is a bit of a surprise, and she basically learns that they're a shit show.
Yep.
And, you know, it's very corporate. This was one of my favorite sort of recurring jokes, I guess, throughout the series, was how overly corporate the superhero stuff is.
Yes, it's very kind of anti-capitalist, I would say, this... this show, which I love.
I mean, there's a bit where A-Train goes to visit kids with cancer as a sort of publicity thing to fill in for Translucent, who's missing because Huey's killed him.
Yep.
And this kid, this cancer kid, just lays into A-Train. He's like, well, I want to... Translucent. And A-Train's like, oh, it's okay, you know, after this I'll take you out and, you know, we'll beat this thing. And this kid's like, you're gonna teach me how to outrun cancer? And it's so painfully awkward. It was fantastic.
Yep.
But yeah, so basically, yeah, so you know, the things, you know, between the superheroes, and I guess the group is called the Boys, although I don't know if that's ever explicitly
called that. Yeah, but
yeah.
Yeah.
I think there's like one or two times where Carl Urban refers to them as the Boys, but it's much more in a colloquial, like how you would describe a group of guys that you're working with way.
Yeah.
So it never felt like an official title. But anyway, things heat up between them and it doesn't really resolve. I was actually very glad to hear that this had been renewed for season two already when I finished it. Because yeah.
It ends in a non-ending way.
Yeah, I wouldn't quite call it a cliffhanger, but there's definitely it's not a finale, really.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, I think someone we haven't really touched on at all that we need to talk about is the leader of the Seven, and arguably the bad guy is Homelander, who is the Superman ripoff.
What a character Homelander is, right? I mean,
he's a great villain.
He is so fucking terrifying. Like, this might be the most terrifying villain I've seen in a while.
Yeah, he's definitely right up there. I think because obviously, like, Brightburn came out recently, which was, you know, basically redoing that Superman origin movie. I don't even remember what they're called anymore. It was basically a Superman origin story, except what if Superman was, like, evil?
Yeah, what if Superman bad? Yeah.
Yes, and obviously Superman in all of his stories is overly good.
Well, except the actual DC Cinematic Universe movies.
Yeah, I haven't really seen those, so yeah. I probably shouldn't talk too much, but Superman.
I mean, people use Superman as a phrase to describe someone being a Boy Scout, right?
Yeah, exactly. Like, in general, he's sort of an overly goody-goody character.
Yeah.
Homelander feels like this much more in-the-middle, fucking terrifying person with so much power who puts on this facade that they're a good person, but underneath they're just a bit of a psycho. Like, and I think that balance is what makes it so much more terrifying. Like, the way he pretends to be the goody-goody Superman and everyone believes it makes him so much more terrifying.
Yeah, and the more you learn that he isn't. He kind of believes it too, right? That's the part that kind of makes him super scary to me, is he sees himself as the superhero. He sees himself as Superman.
Yes, although he sees himself as better than everyone, and he puts on the show because it's easier, but you sort of get the sense as the season's wrapping up that he's probably not going to bother with that much anymore.
Maybe. It's hard to...
I mean, there really is a sort of sense that if the rest of the world turned against him, he'd still win.
Yeah. It's kind of... Like, thinking about it, how could any of the Seven stop Homelander? I mean, like, maybe A-Train would be able to do something? I don't know. I don't think so.
Yeah, or if Starlight's power somehow is, like, his kryptonite. Yeah. I don't know. Like that's something the show actually explicitly brings up, is that everyone's searching for his weakness in a kryptonite sort of fashion, and there isn't one. In fact, the closest they come is in the finale. Carl Urban thinks it is Miss Sitwell, who is the... manager of the Seven.
That Homelander has a weird Oedipus-style crush on.
Oedipus is the perfect phrase for that. And so Carl Urban thinks that's his weakness, but it turns out he's just a bit psycho. Of course, now he's got the Sun, which I think will sort of fit that bill. Mm. So, yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think what else to say about this show. Like, I think more than any other show that lives on my recent memory, this is a show where every episode there were just like one or two absolute like what the fuck or what the hell scenes.
There are a lot of moments that just kind of floor you in this show, right?
Like a lot of other shows will have maybe a couple of those a season or just sort of be consistently good.
Yeah.
This show very much, at the end of every episode, I was able to point to one or two scenes that were just like individually fantastic, like very memorable scenes.
Yes,
some of those were because of the special effects and the gore.
Yeah.
Like the scene where Robin gets killed by A-Train as he flies through her. The scene where the Deep kidnaps a dolphin and then is forced to stop and the dolphin flies through
the windscreen.
The thing then gets hit by a truck. Similarly, the plane scene.
I want to talk about this airplane scene because to me, this is the scene that defines this show to me, right? It's so if you haven't seen it yet, go see it. It's awesome. What are you doing? I know it's on Amazon Prime. You'll just have to excuse that for a moment. This scene is Homelander and Wonder Woman. What's her name?
Queen Maeve.
Queen Maeve are tasked with rescuing a plane as a kind of PR thing. There's a plane that's going down and they can save it. And they get there and realize that they won't have enough time to save the plane. Interestingly,
it's something dumb that Homelander does that causes them to not be able to do it anymore. It's his carelessness that kills the pilot and damages the controls so that they can't actually fly the plane.
Yeah, so the plane's going down. They have time to save some people, but Homelander says, no, if we only save some of them, it'll kind of break the illusion of heroes being able to do everything. We have to just pretend that we got here too late to do anything and the plane crashed. And we get this scene of Homelander leaving and Queen Maeve kind of being forced to go along with this, even though she clearly doesn't want to, just because what else can she do? It's Homelander, right?
Yeah, pretty much. And I mean, I think that's Queen Maeve, I think, serves sort of two purposes in this season. Like, she doesn't really have much of an individual arc, but the first thing she does is she's very much the sort of second most powerful person that we see. Like, every scene of her that's by herself is her absolutely kicking ass.
Yeah.
And then every other scene where she's near Homelander, she's clearly fucking terrified of him. Yes. So it helps establish his threat level because it's sort of, we know how powerful and competent she is and how generally strong she is as a person, not just like physically.
Yeah.
And she's clearly fucking terrified of him. So it makes you more terrified of Homelander.
Yeah.
And then the other role she serves is she's kind of what Starlight might be in 10 years if she had just stayed with the Seven.
Yeah, I see her role there as being a bit kind of like, there needs to be something to let us know that not everybody is an irredeemable sack of shit completely and utterly, right? Like, it would just be too depressing if every single member of the Seven was completely irredeemable. And so we need some hints that I think Queen Maeve is at least somewhat redeemable. Similarly, kind of with the Deep, A-Train, they all kind of have these bits of they're human. Except Homelander, who is not. He's a fucking psychopath.
But, yes.
The rest of them, they need to be human. And I think that's kind of what that her relationship with Starlight shows, is that she is human. She does have a soul.
Yeah, yeah. You're right. The plane scene is very powerful for many reasons. And then the episode it's in is capped off with Homelander giving his speech to help get the superheroes into the military, where he kind of blames it on the terrorists. And it's so...
It's horrible. It's horrifying. It's
a very powerful scene. It's really good.
Can we talk about the Deep for a bit? Because the Deep The Deep is the one part of this show that I don't know how to reconcile in my head. Because we first meet the Deep when he's the first of the Seven that Starlight meets properly. And he says to her, "Hey, if you want to stay on this team, I'm important enough that you have to make sure I'm happy with you," and then gets her to... He sexually assaults her. He you know, rapes her, I guess is the word.
It's definitely just straight up rape, essentially.
Yes. Yeah. And then he just kind of goes off into the background and has a series of comedic misadventures. And I don't know how to feel about it, because he does like, the first thing we see him do is so sickening, right? And it is the thing that shows us, hey, actually the Seven aren't what you thought they were going to be. He's the symbol of that at the start of the show to Starlight, and then he just kind of has this arc afterwards where he's not redeemed, but you do kind of feel sorry for him, and he just kind of becomes goofy, and it's very I really don't know what to make of it.
Yeah, I mean, for me, there are two parts to his journey in the second half. I think there's the part where you come to understand that, like, he's a bit of a victim too. I was actually talking to my sisters about this, and they like one of my sisters was saying like the Deep's character arc was her favorite part of the show, because she liked how it showed that in general most of the people who like abuse other people like that are victims in their own way, and that's sort of what she took away from it. And I agree, like I sort of see that, like particularly in the bits where he's in Sandusky in Ohio.
Yeah.
And a girl essentially like rapes him.
Yes.
And it's sort of implied that maybe not that's happened before, but you know, it's like his gills are something he's very insecure about. And so I can see this plot where you're sort of talking about how, you know, the people who abuse others are victims in their own way, and they're sort of pushing that forward and perpetuating cycles, and you know, it's sort of everyone's a victim.
I agree with the other half
of that journey though is this attempt to turn him into the goofball, and that's the part that doesn't work for me. Because it's hard to appreciate the goofy humor parts when we already hate him so much for what he did in episode one.
Yes, and so you mentioned the scene with him kind of escaping the dolphin, and that was kind of a bit where I was kind of like, I can't, this scene is obviously trying to be funny, and I just can't get behind it, because three episodes ago he raped the character that we, like, I think the one character that we actually like that gets out of this pretty squeaky clean.
Yeah, I think Starlight and Huey are the only two I would sort of call good people, and yes, Huey kind of pushes that.
Yeah, Huey definitely jeopardizes his good person status throughout this series.
But yeah, no, I would agree. Like, I think I can sort of see what they were going for with the Deep, with this idea of a plot line that involves sort of talking about how, you know, the abusers are the victims. I just don't think they quite hit the mark there.
I think it's because they didn't have a thing that they were building to. Like, if the Deep had come back in some way and had taken part in something, like some dismantling of the Seven or whatever it is, I mean, maybe that would have been a bit too heavy-handed, though. I don't know. I guess...
And maybe they'll get there.
He still exists, so I guess we'll see what happens with him in Season 2. I expect something to happen. I just don't know what it is.
No, but I agree. I'm not sure if I have any suggestions for how to improve it, but I definitely think it's something that could have been handled better.
Yeah.
Because when you especially, you know, when you're dealing with a very, you know, tricky topic like that, no doubt, if that is sort of what they were going for, that's like a very touchy thing.
Yeah, it's a hard line to walk, huh?
Yeah, you got to be really careful about how you approach it. And I don't think in trying to inject comedy in there was probably the right call.
Yeah. Have we talked about the show being funny? I mean, it's a black comedy, right? That's kind of how it's categorized.
Yeah, definitely. All the humor is generally like black comedy.
Yes. I quite liked a lot of the scenes with the Christian superheroes. That felt like a very funny source of comedy to me.
Ezekiel?
Yes. And there were a few other superheroes in the Christian superhero camp that I just found it was that all that stuff was quite entertaining.
I mean, something that I sort of want to complain a little bit about, and maybe this is just because Worm has ruined me, but I had like written in my notes about four or five episodes in that I didn't like. I had in my notes about four or five episodes in that I kind of like that they're just ignoring the origin of superheroes, and it's just they're in the world, just deal with it. And then they obviously introduce this plotline that it turns out all superheroes are being manufactured.
Yeah,
and this started in the 70s, and that didn't really work for me because I think that's the first point we're introduced to the concept that superheroes have only been around for like 40 years. That's the thing that doesn't sort of like, it feels weird to me that the world has just so readily accepted superheroes if they only sprouted up in the 70s. Yeah,
to the extent that they're stars of films, which feels like it's at least a second or third step in the accepting superheroes process. Yeah,
like the concept that this is, that they're still just a corporate entity and everything is just kind of, It feels like kind of shonky world building to me so far.
Yeah, no, that's fair. I think some of the things need superheroes to be young, like the fact that they are talking about can superheroes be a part of the military as a pretty key plot line for some of the stuff that's going on. That kind of needs them to be young, but I agree they didn't really seed that idea super strongly.
Yeah, like obviously, so something that comes up is that Vought perpetuates this idea that the Supes were chosen by God.
Yep.
And That's why so many of them are very much involved in this like Christian scene throughout America.
Yep.
And again, that's something that doesn't feel established until after they reveal this thing that the babies are being injected.
Yep.
And so it's sort of like I feel like the in the world it would make sense if there'd been like a massive boost in like, you know, the number of people attending these sorts of Christian things, because like I think that would convert a lot of people, because there's a bit less faith needed if you genuinely believe that God is creating superheroes, right?
Yes. I think that would be pretty compelling evidence.
Yeah, like it certainly leads to a smaller leap of faith being needed. And it's interesting that because something that Homelander does towards the end of the series is, in order to help push this along, he creates terrorist superheroes to justify needing the soups for the war.
Yep.
Which, like, very much, it doesn't show a lot of forward thinking, because that very much invalidates the whole soups chosen by God thing. If suddenly, like, the Islamic terrorists also have them, like that.
Yeah, you know, soups were chosen by their God too.
Well, yeah, exactly. You know, these are both religions that sort of rely on their path being the only path. So I don't really understand how he thinks that's going to work.
It's a bit weird to think, oh yeah, that God, the chosen for him were the terrorists. Like, it's very, I mean, I guess it's a quite anti-Christian show, but that would be a bit of a weird message to be sending. The message that people buy, like, the Christian God chooses the good people to become superheroes, but no, that Islamic God, he chooses the bad people to become superheroes. I mean,
well, the ironic thing is, like, at the end of the day, the Islamic and Christian God, it's the same God.
Yeah.
So, like, they just both believe different things about him. So
I mean, maybe the message is meant to be like, God put these superheroes on her, but now Satan has learned how to make superheroes too, or whatever.
I mean, that's surely how Vought would try to spin it, but that, like, it's this whole thing.
Yeah, no, it's fair.
Yeah.
Fair point.
Anyway, I mean, yeah, so just talking about the bit where they find the babies are being injected.
Yeah.
The bit where Carl Urban's character uses the baby with lightsaber eyes to just maul everyone is hilarious. And in fact, that's something, like, I love all the scenes where Homelander is using his laser, because they don't shy away from the gore of it. Like, people are explosively cut in half.
Yes.
It's really intense, and I quite liked that.
Yeah, I think that one of the things this show set out to do is really show you how gory superpowers would really be in real life. Right from the get-go, that's what happens with A-Train, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
I want to come around to the idea of exploring the world behind the soups a bit, because you're right that I think some of it falls on its face, but the parts, like, Homelander's descent into full-on madness is so compelling to me. Like, it's so... It just is incredible. Like, it's incredible to watch. And the actor, whose name I don't remember, is... Like, he does so well.
You're right. Like, the slide, in at least our perspective, onto just how unhinged he is and how terrified everyone is of him is very well done. And the you're right. The actor's ability to switch from the cheerful, put-on, nice Superman Homelander to the psychotic, evil one that's under the hood is like phenomenal.
There's a lot of excellent acting in this. Stillwell, who's the CEO of Vought, is it?
Yeah, well, I think she's the vice president or at the moment.
Sure, she's responsible for the seven. And she is incredible. Her character arc in this is incredible, because you kind of think that she's the villain for most of the show, until we kind of find out, oh no, Homelander's basically just kind of intimidating everybody into basically doing what he wants.
Yeah, I'd still say she's not a very good person.
I'm with you there, man.
You know, she's not the villain, but you know, she's a shit person still. She just ends up being another victim of Homelander's because of the position she was in, which is a bit unfortunate for her.
Yeah.
I think so. The only other thing I want to mention is part of the group that is the boys, apart from Carl Urban and Huey, is they also recruit a guy who's called Mother's Milk, and that's never explained.
Great.
It's a fun name. But the real MVP of the show for me was Frenchie, who's a French guy.
Classic.
You know, Carl Urban's character is not very creative with his nicknames.
Yeah, he does very Australian nicknames.
And like Frenchie's really, I think, in a lot of ways, the heart of their group.
Yeah.
Huey's sort of the heart who doesn't stand up as the heart, and yeah. Frenchie's the one who actually cares. And he has a very interesting arc because he starts completely detached from everyone, particularly the women in his life, and then sort of falls for this, you know, girl who was being dosed with the Compound V to turn her into an evil, crazed super villain.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't know, I just actually really enjoyed that little subplot as it went on.
Yeah, I think they all, I found them all quite compelling. I mean, like, you know, Frenchie is obviously great, but Mother's Milk, he's not as main of a character, but he does have his, like, his moments, right?
Yeah, definitely. He's probably just a bit too straight for me to call him, like, super interesting. Like, he's in a way the straight man of their group, which, like, you need that, but, like, he sort of serves as kind of the basic moral compass a lot of the time. I don't know, whereas Frenchie's a bit more out there in the way he approaches this stuff, but just as endearing, if not more.
Yeah, yeah. I think one of the other great things about this show is Starlight, her human name is Annie January, which is such a, it's such a comic book name for a human to have. Like, it's so on point.
Yeah.
It's great. Good stuff. It's a great show all around. And I actually haven't read the comic that it's based on, but just like there's a bunch of cool stuff in there. I kind of want to go back and read it just to kind of make the connections, but I also don't want to spoil myself for later.
Yeah, I'm very much looking forward to catching up on season two of this whenever it comes out. I think there's so much superhero content out there these days, but this is sort of something that'll make the cut for me. It's a very enjoyable interpretation of superhero stories.
We haven't kind of touched on more of the overt themes of, you know, how this is talking about Hollywood celebrity culture and stuff. And we could, but I don't think we need to say that much about it. Beyond the fact that I think it's hilarious that Haley Joel Osment is like the grown-up child star superhero.
I was going to say that role. It's pretty spot on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did enjoy it. Like, I loved how corporate it all was. You know, the bit like where they give Starlight the new outfit in like the third episode, and it's just this skimpy revealing thing, and it's just like, oh fuck, they would. they nailed it all. It was very fun to watch.
Yeah.
This sort of satire of, you're right, corporate publicity culture.
So that's The Boys. Do you have more that you want to say about it, Elliot?
No, I think that's pretty much it. As I said, I'm keen to see season two. I really enjoyed this, and if I had to put a number to that, I think I'm going to give this an 8.5.
Nice.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this, and it wasn't perfect, but it's good enough to keep me coming back for season two.
Good work resisting the urge to give it the 7 out of 10.
I mean, Amazon. Sorry, just one comment before we go.
Yeah,
Amazon's really stepping up their original content selection. Like, just looking at it now, I think you know, Netflix used to be the subscription that had all the best original shows, and that was why I kept it. Whereas looking at it now, all the original shows I'm interested in now are all on Amazon. Like, we've talked about Good Omens, The Boys, The Expanse is now an Amazon exclusive. Like, their library is getting really strong, and Netflix's is waning more and more.
I gotta say, I've just started Mindhunter, and boy, that show's good. That's a pretty good Netflix original.
Okay.
But maybe we'll save that for another time.
Okay.
Speaking of, it's your turn, Elliot. What have you got for us all to check out?
I'm bringing something a little bit different, I guess, this week. Like,
you mean it's not another inversion of superhero tropes? Wait, are we even allowed to talk about other things?
I don't know how well this is going to be suited to our format. So I guess this is another little experimental one, which most of my little experimental things haven't gone very well. So
okay. We'll
see how this one goes. I'm bringing you a YouTube series called Tier Zoo.
Okay.
And that's tier as in like top tier.
Okay.
And then zoo, like,
yep, like a zoo
with the animals. Gotcha. I haven't binged this series. I'm actually still making my way through it right now, so I'll probably be watching a chunk of this over the next 2 weeks as well.
Okay.
But this is a series where this guy basically talks about zoology stuff, so like talks about animal stuff, as if he's talking about the meta of like a video game.
Okay.
So basically, it's like this weirdly educational series that hides the education behind pretending it's talking about video games.
Behind and a solid layer of game memes.
Yeah, and I don't know why this works for me so well, but like I found myself really enjoying this series. I don't know how bingeable it is, and so that's part of why I'm worried about bringing it here.
Yeah.
Sorry. So that's part of why I'm a little worried about bringing it here, because I don't know if, like, you know, you just chugging through as much as you can in 2 weeks is going to be a good thing. but, like, I've been sort of slowly making my way through it over the last, like, handful of weeks, and I found it, you know, really fun to pop on every now and then.
How much of this is there?
It's about, he brings out, like, a video every week or so. And it's been going for a couple of years. So there's a good amount of them.
And is each one like a different animal or?
It's all sorts of different things. So like I pulled out some highlights from the most recent like 10 or so, just to give you an idea. So, you know, some of the recent ones have been entitled like Pigs Used to Be Overpowered.
Okay.
The Ice Age tier list. The tier list ones are some of my favorites, where he sort of creates tier lists for a period of history.
Okay.
And yeah, so top five animal team combos, and then like the deep sea meta.
Okay.
And I mean, you know, that's sort of the language in this show is very fun. Like he talks about, you know, the Cretaceous expansion. I just watched one about dinosaurs, so all my examples are going to be dinosaur based. So, you know, he talks about the Cretaceous expansion, or you know, how dinosaurs were nerfed in the Meteor update.
Yeah.
And it's really fun. Like it's such a fun conceit, and hides, like, I've actually sort of learnt a lot about animals and stuff as I've been going through it. So I don't know if we'll have all that much to talk about it next week, but I thought it was really fun, and I think people should check it out.
Okay. Tier Zoo. Is this a start at the start and go, or?
I've been jumping back and forth. You know how YouTube will just recommend you something else, like, randomly throughout.
That's going to drive me mental.
I'm currently sort of at that point where I'm trying to, like, find specific ones, and it's a bit more tedious because I've jumped all over the place already. So I don't know. There's definitely a production quality difference between the originals and the current ones, and that's due to sponsorships and Patreons he's picked up in the meantime.
Mm.
So I wouldn't suggest you only watch, like, you know, the first videos from the first quarter over the next 2 weeks. Like, you might want to jump around a bit. But yeah, like, I think even from the get-go, it's still pretty good.
I guess we'll check it out, and we'll see what we think of it in a fortnight when we're back to talk about Tier Zoo. But that's the end of our episode for this fortnight. Thanks for joining us, folks. If you have comments on Tier Zoo, please leave them in the Discord channel, the Doof Media Discord, or you can tweet them at us at MediaMDPodcast.
Yes, the other way is to email us at MediaMDPodcast@gmail.com. I shouldn't have started that with that. That's confusing. MediaMDPodcast@gmail.com is our email address.
Yeah. If you're looking for how to get access to that cool Discord that we just mentioned, it's available to everybody who backs Doof Media on Patreon. So if you want to find out more, go to patreon.com/doofmedia.
Yes, and if you want to find out even more about, like, what Doof Media is and why you should support it, head to doofmedia.com, and it's got all the details on all the many great shows on the Doof Network. It's a really great collection of you know, shows analyzing different bits of media.
Yeah. You can find shows like Deep Impact, which is our other show that we do. You can check out also What You Say, which is a new OC discussion podcast, which I'm very into. All kinds of things. You can find links to all the things we mentioned, ways to contact us, other shows. Oh, and all of the clues for the Media MD ARG. You can help us figure out just who is Dr. MD and why is his Superman so super mean? Elliot, why don't you tell the listeners this fortnight's clue?
Sound.
Sound. And we'll see you next fortnight.